I'd love to invite Dr. Ramajaya Sundar to talk about mantra from metaphysics to biophysics. Ramaji is not only a PhD from Cambridge University, UK, but also a BAMS. So she is a doctor who's a doctor. Let's welcome Ramaji and listen to what promises to be an interesting talk. Namaste, Ramaji.
Can I have the first slide? So it's a great honor for me to be here at the first Indic Thoughts Festival, and I thank the organizers for the invite. Mananat Rayate Iti Mantraha, so goes the definition. And the translation is that which protects because of repeated utterance. Next one. Does this fall in the realm of metaphysics? Is it going to open the doors to different levels of awareness and reality? Next one. Or is it squarely in the domain of biophysics, affecting changes at both the physical and physiological level? Next one. To even address these two questions, we need to understand how Vedas perceives the human system, because mantras are an inseparable part of Vedas, and the best way to visualize this or understand this is to see how Ayurveda, which is again a part of Veda, understands and perceives the human system. So you see in the figure that there are four domains that Ayurveda uses to understand the human system. You have a structural domain, you have a physiological domain, you have a psychological domain, and a domain of consciousness, which is the subtlest one. Each of these domains is interconnected, and I have mentioned at the top, at the side. So for example, the structural domain is interconnected using various channels. These are called srotas in Ayurveda. These channels can be blood vessels, lymphatic vessels, or nerves. The physiological domain is connected network within by parameters which are defined by Vata, Pitta, and Kapha, which are subclassified into 15 types each. The psychological domain is uses the parameters of sattva, rajas, and tamas, which we have heard the other speakers mention also. And these are subclassified into 16 subtypes. And then you have the domain of consciousness, which is networked through the levels of the koshas, the pancha koshas. Now, what is interesting is that each of these domains is also interconnected. You can see the area of overlap. The structural and the functional physiological domain is connected through parameters of Vata, Pitta, and Kapha, and so are the other domains. So each of these domains actually influence each other, and what is easy to measure is what happens at the physical and the physiological domain, and you can draw the inference from these to the psychological domain. Next one. So there are three things that can be done with mantra. One can read the mantra, one can chant it, or one can meditate upon. Each of these three activities is going to cause different changes in the brain. Let's see what modern science has got to offer to measure these changes. Next one. So this slide shows the electrical activity of the brain when words are spoken or when the same words are heard. So the words are the same, but the top two figures shows the electrical activity in the brain when it's spoken. The next one is when it's heard. You can see the difference in the electrical activity in the brain. The next slide. So this one shows the changes in the blood flow when the same words are heard or seen or spoken or thought of. Next one. Now I am going to show a very interesting experiment which can show another aspect of mantra or sound. Give a click, please. So this is an inverted speaker, and now we are going to fill it with water, and then you can switch the music on. It can be any music, it can be a sound, it can be a swara or a note. Next one. And with proper lighting, you will see a picture like this. So this is called cymatic photography, and which helps visualize representation of visual representation of sound energy or the vibrational energy. Next one. I'm going to show you some interesting patterns which have been affected by different swaras and sounds. So the pioneers of this cymatic photography are, it's a German physicist, Ernst Schladming, And he was also father of acoustics and the Swiss physician and scientist Hans Jenny. Next one. So this slide shows the experiments which were conducted in the early stages of cinematography. So you can see that the person is playing, that's Hans Jenny's hands there. He is playing the notes in the piano, and then connected to that is a metal plate over which very fine corn flour has been sprinkled with different notes, different patterns were being formed by the corn flour. And the one you see on the right side is a very simple rudimentary experimental setup with a frequency generator and a metal plate over it. So you can either sprinkle corn flour or even very finely ground sand, and different notes, sounds will give different rise to different give rise to different patterns. Next one. So these are some of the patterns which have been photographed on water. The vibrations of the sound gives these patterns, and with proper lighting. So this has been done by a sound engineer. So you can see the beautiful patterns from, these are all notes from the piano. Next one. So this one gives a full range of patterns, visual patterns that can be captured with proper lighting on water. Next one. So the one on the left side is a pattern that's formed in water when a 40 hertz sine wave is given to the water. And the next one is a 52.8 hertz vibration which can be captured on the water. Next one. Now this is a vibration of a 27 hertz sine wave in a 54 millimeter cup of water. And the next slide is a very interesting superposition of these vibrations, which is visual representation of that sine wave on the MR image. So what you see on the left side is a MR image of, it's the axial section of brain. You can see the eyes and the nose and the gray matter and the white matter. And the vibrations which have resulted from the 27 hertz sine wave has been superimposed on the MR image. You can wonder about the rationale between for this superimposition. It's simple. Our body is made up of 80% water, and the brain also is made up of 80% water. And the vibrations that you can capture in a cup of water can be captured, would occur in the brain as well. Also, there would be some attenuation because of the viscosity of the tissues. And you can see that the center part of that pattern is coinciding with the pineal gland. So traditionally, we say that the pineal gland represents the third eye, according to the Hindus. Next one. Now, I'm going to shift gear a bit and go on to some studies that I have carried out on the effect of mantra. So just a very, very brief introduction to the technique I have used, because I think it's important to understand the parameter that's being measured. So this magnetic resonance spectroscopy studies the magnetic properties of the nucleus. So we all know that any physical structure is made up of atoms and molecules, and atoms are made up of protons and neutrons which are in the nucleus, and then the electrons. So the technique actually looks at the subatomic, the magnetic field associated with the subatomic particle. Next. So any charged particle in motion is going to have a magnetic field associated with it. It can be a linear motion or a rotational motion or a spinning motion. You saw that motion of the protons there. So it spins on its own axis, just like Earth spins on its own axis. And because it's a charged particle, it's going to have a magnetic field associated with it. And it is, next one, it is this magnetic field occurring associated with the nucleus that is measured in magnetic resonance spectroscopy. It can give information from molecules to the level of organs. Next one. So for my study, I chose Gayatri Mantra because it's considered the most potent and powerful mantra. Next one. And Gayantam Trayate Iti Gayatri, that which protects those who repeat and meditate upon it. There are so many attributes to what Gayatri Mantra can do. I'm not going into the details. I'm sure that most of you would know the kind of the importance and power of Gayatri Mantra. Next one. So this is the protocol I used. The study was for a period of 9 months. The first 3 months, so there were about 30 volunteers. They were divided into groups of 10 each. The first group recited Gayatri Mantra in Sanskrit Gayatri Mantra as it is. The second group recited that English translation. The third group did not, there was no chanting, there was no reciting any mantra. So all these volunteers who recited Gayatri Mantra, they used to get up at 2:30 or 3 in the morning, and they recited it for 108 times. And the people, the volunteers who chanted it in English also did exactly the same thing. They used to get up at 2:30 or 3 in the morning and then recite it 108 times. So the first 3 months were baseline study, as you can see in the graph there. And then for the next 3 months, they were chanting, and then it was a follow-up period of 3 months, and every week MR spectrum was taken. Next one. So this is how a MR spectrum would look like. So this is the MR spectrum from normal human brain. You can see some neurochemicals here. For example, NAA stands for N-acetyl aspartate. It can be found only in neurons. So the information that you get from NAA represents, gives information about neurons. And you can see the glutamate and creatine and choline. These are all neurochemicals that's found in brain. And you see the arrow and then two voxels, there, two squares there. So this spectrum has been obtained from one of those voxels, one of those squares. Now, in this particular study, looking at the effect of Gayatri Mantra, what I had done is I had obtained spectrum from both the hemispheres. So there was spectrum from the left hemisphere, and that is the frontal part of the brain, which is involved in thought processes. And so then I acquired another one from the right hemisphere. I was looking at the asymmetrical distribution of these neurochemicals and whether there is any change that is affected by Gayatri Mantra. Next one. So this is the result of what happens to the asymmetrical distribution of neurochemicals when Gayatri Mantra is recited. So you see that there are random variations before the Gayatri Mantra was recited. And then as the Gayatri Mantra recitation starts, you know, then for the next 3 months, you see a reduction in the asymmetry. You see it coming towards unity, so which means that there is a balance of neurochemicals between the left and the right hemisphere. And the follow-up period, so there are 3 months after the chanting is stopped, you can still see that the effect of the reduction in asymmetry is sustained. Next one. So language does matter, because you see the data here. The first one shows what happens when Gayatri Mantra is recited, chanted in Sanskrit. You see the reduction in the asymmetry. And in the group which were reciting the Gayatri Mantra or reading out the English translation 108 times every day for 3 months, you see that the random variations persist. So language does seem to play a role, at least in causing some changes in the neurochemicals. So mantra seems to be a key to different realms. What I have shown and what is possible with the modern scientific tools is measurement at both the physical and physiological level. There are some measurements which are also possible at the psychological level, but you know, even changes in the physiological level means that we can infer that there would be changes at the psychological level. So next one. So if we go back to this figure, because the entire human system is connected, networked, it doesn't matter whether it's metaphysics or biophysics, each one is going to influence the other domains. So the results I have shown happens at the biophysical realm, and it's not so easy to measure what happens at the metaphysical realm, but what we can infer is, if something, the metaphysical realm will happen at the level of the consciousness, and that will percolate down as changes at both the physiological and the psychological, as well as the structural domain. Thank you. I think that's the last slide.